אוקיי, שלום, ברוכים הבאים לפאנל הפריצה לחול, במסגרת הוועידה הנחמדה שיש לנו כאן. כמו שבוודאי רובכם יודעים, העידן הגלובלי די מקצר, די מפיל חומות, מקצר גבולות, והמון המון המון אומנים ישראלים, ולא רק, כבר לא מחפשים רק את הפריצה הזאת לתוך השוק המקומי, לא מסתפקים במועדון הברבי, הזאפה ואפילו גם לא בקיסריה, והם רוצים לחפש את ה... את הרגע הזה שבו הם יכלו להגיד לעצמם, אני אומן עם קריירה בינלאומית. זה לא חדש, אבל תמיד יש דברים מעניינים ללמוד, ללמוד על התחום. פעם, הרי אם לפני כמה וכמה שנים היינו אומרים, בוא תפתח חמוד במייספייס, אנחנו יודעים שהיום האמירה הזאת לא שווה כלום. ובמסגרת הפאנל הזה אנחנו ננסה להבין איך, מה הם הכלים שאומנים צריכים, אומנים ישראלים צריכים כדי לבצע את הפריצה הזאת. אנחנו נלמד פה מאנשים עם הרבה ניסיון, וידע גם מהשוק הבינלאומי וגם מהשוק הישראלי. אני אציג אותם ממש בשורה כל אחד, ולאחר מכן אנחנו, לאחר מכן כל אחד יציג את עצמו קצת יותר בהרחבה, ואז נעבור באמת לדיון עצמו. זה כמובן יתנהל מן הסתם בעברית ובאנגלית. I'll now introduce everyone, everybody, and one of you, and after that I will ask you to take a mic and introduce yourself. סקזי, אתה, יש לך, אתה הכי קצר פה, אתה יכול, אתה יכול, אתה הכי פחות, הכי פחות להתחיל. אז אנחנו נתחיל לפי הסדר. We have here Mr. Claudio Trotta, is the owner and promoter of Barley Arts Promotion Company, one largest in Italy. We have here Mr. Mark Bona, the promoter of Ziget Festival, and we have Nora Pinter. She's a marketing lady of Ziget Festival. Ziget Festival, for those of you who doesn't know, is one of Europe's biggest festival with headliners such as, I think this year you have Rihanna.
Yeah.
Rihanna is like this major pop, but also a lot of Indian rock and roll artists that perform in, it's in Budapest, right?
Yeah.
Ziget is in Budapest, right?
Yes, in Budapest, in the middle of August, from 10th to 17th.
Every one of you that doesn't get to Hungary this summer, you have everything to do there. We have, יש לנו את אשר ביטנסקי, מפיק רב פעלים, ותיק, עבד עם אחינועם ניני, עידן רייכל, ומבין הלהקות האהובות עליי אי פעם בישראל, איזבו. יש לנו את סקזי, שהוא סקזי. יוצר, מפיק, די-ג'יי, כוכב טלוויזיה ומניסיון איש מצחיק. ויש לנו את שוקי פרי מהלייבל הנובה, מארגוני המוזיקה היותר מעניינים שפעלו בישראל, לא רק בגלל שהוא מתעסק בהרבה בשוליים, אלא גם בגלל האופן שבו הוא משלב כן עבודה בחול ועבודה בישראל, מבלי לתת איזושהי עדיפות, בלי שלפחות זה נראה כלפי חוץ, לתת איזושהי עדיפות גדולה לאחד מהם, ולכן זה עושה את העבודה שלהם לעוד יותר מעניינת. ועכשיו אני אפנה לכל אחד מהם, ובקש שיציגו בקצרה את עצמם, את עבודתם, ואחר כך נמשיך לדבר. מיסטר טרוטה, please begin by introducing yourself a bit, please explain about your work, how does your job interact with the topic of this discussion about the breaking of an artist to the international market, a bit about how it's work in your country, in specifically in the music industry of Italy.
Okay. Do I have 1 year to talk? No, actually I'm 58 years old. I start this job on my own with my own company that I wasn't 21st. I'm still independent. I'm one of the only left in the world in a high level, myself, Neo Sala in Spain, Peter Eichen in Ireland, and really few others, not too many. Most of them, they sold the company to Live Nation or AEG or Warner Bros. Or Universe or whatever it is. When I start, it was completely another world. It was no web, not even the fax. It was the telex, but probably most of you even don't know what it is, and no cell phone, and the communication was completely different. The exchange of information was completely different. Was a world where the domestic act were very, very strong in most of the European country on their own, and the international act have a different market, a completely different market. What I did in all these years, I mean, I can't tell you because it's not enough time. Basically, at the moment, my job, I have different levels. I am a promoter and producer of Italian international act. I promote in Italy act like Bruce Springsteen, AC/DC, Kiss, Chemical Brothers, The Cure, Mika, Deep Purple, a lot of other artists. I also promote and book and produce Italian act. I'm also working on two other fields. One is festival food, but this is not the conference to talk about, even if it's all about track food and music. So it's quite interesting, but maybe we talk about this later on. And I also produce and book worldwide exhibition, edutainment exhibition, one about the space and one about football. Basically, in all my nearly 40 years, I have promoted act from all over the world. Obviously, America, Canada, but Australia, England, Spain, Sweden, Denmark, Balkany, Ireland, from everywhere. But this is not typical, because most of the promoter, to be honest, especially in these days, they don't give much a damn about exploiting festivals. They do that, but because festivals, they do have a different role, a different position, and also some of them, they do believe in what they do. Some of them, they do work for the music. And it's important to exchange information. Yesterday I've seen the shows, and a couple of bands were amazing. Names. Really amazing. The name, not the last one, the two before. Okay. Especially the one with the fat guy. I mean, he is a star. He is amazing.
Shai Tzabari, the only fat guy in Israeli music.
And Uba Bazooka, no?
What? Ah, Uzo Bazooka.
And actually what I'm doing every time that I go in a country outside of Italy, I go in a record store. Yesterday my good friend Avizar took me in Tel Aviv, and I spent 1,500 local currency in buying Israel music. And I think everyone should do that, not buying Israel music only, I'm saying, but when we go somewhere, because it's all about exchange.
All right. Miss Painter, please.
Hi, I'm Nora Pinter from Sziget, Hungary, and as it was introduced, Sziget Festival is the biggest festival in Hungary, and I think in the Central European region also. That will be the 24th this year, and I worked there for 12 years, so half of them I take part as a worker, and I'm work for the marketing department. We are doing the communication and the marketing stuffs, and we take care of sponsors and sponsorship agreements. So Sziget has international history after the 2005 or 2006, so it is more than 10 years from now. So we have a really huge promoter network all around Europe, and we are working with travel agencies and promoter companies. So most of the visitors of Sziget Festival, which is 80,000 per day, and it's a 7 days festival, so lots of people come to Budapest for Sziget Festival. So most of the visitors came from abroad. It's very special, because every festival all around the world, locals are the biggest part of the visitors, and according to Sziget, it's around 80% who came from abroad and who stay for 1 week. So touristically, it's very important for Budapest.
It's a 5 day festival, if I remember correctly, or 6 days.
Five full festival days we have, and two warm up days. Rihanna will play on one of these warm up days.
Oh, the warm up.
Yeah.
You can give another headline that will perform in the festival itself.
Yes, Muse will play, I think, and Sia, David Guetta, and Jake Bugg, I don't know, Rising Murphy. So a lot of performers are there, more than more than 60 venues we have, not only music, but theater and circus venues, and we have lots of other things.
Just to understand how big is this festival, everybody knows most of the European festivals are 3 days, weekend days. Some of them, like Primavera or other, or have like two warm-up days, the day before and the day after, so they grow up like 5 days. Sziget and Roskilde, if I remember correctly, are festivals that happen like a whole week, and it's
a whole week, and you can move in, yeah, two days before this 7 days, so it's 9 days, if yeah, we are correct.
All right, your turn.
Hello, my name is Mark Bona. I'm working for the music business for almost 20 years. I was a roadie at first for a very famous Hungarian pop band. Then later on I was working for clubs, and then I was working for the Sziget for 10 years. I was the program coordinator for the Sziget Festival only, then I became the production manager of the Sziget company, so I took care of all the Sziget company's festivals. So I've been in charge for the stages, sound, lights, everything. Then I quit and I was working for clubs, but I'm still working for the Sziget. There is the Europe stage, which is it's a smaller stage, but it's for this, so we are exploring bands. And the point is to have bands who are already well known in their country, and we want to show them to this very international audience. And we have bands who has their audience at the Sziget, yeah, but we give the chance to
your uncles
to check, yeah, to see by every other countries and all the audience. So it's a nice one. It's very successful now.
All right. We'll talk about it a lot in about a minute. Mr. Bitansky.
עברית או אנגלית?
עברית, זה בסדר.
אני מפתח מוזיקה וקריירות של אומנים מגיל 16. בדרך כלל האומנים שאני עובד איתם פחות ידועים או לא ידועים בכלל בשלב העבודה של השנה, שנתיים הראשונות. הלהקה הראשונה שלי כוורת, הזמרות הראשונות שלי נתנלה ונורית גלרון. הלהקה שאני עובד איתה בשנתיים האחרונות היא בונאפייד 3000, רובכם לא יודעים את השם, 150
מופעות. אני אעצור אותך ואני מקבל את הצעתו של I accept Mr. Trotta because he doesn't have a translation, please do it in English.
I suggested English.
Yes,
I'm happy you are pushing for it. Okay, I feel better with our guest.
A good host acknowledges mistakes. Please do.
It's okay. I'm supporting music and developing careers since I'm 16 years of age. My first artists are Kaveret, for our guests, it's the biggest ever rock group in Israel, and Netanela and Norit Galron on the vocal side. Later on, in early 90s, I fell upon Noah, Achinoam Nini. I realized a note I had when I was at high school that I want to develop Israeli music for the world. And it began a wonderful journey with different artists for whom I've been part of the international development, including Idan Reichel, Avishai Cohen, Isabeau. These days, Anat Fort is releasing her ECM album. She's a pianist. And we will hear about more later.
Okay, Skazi, your turn in English, please.
Yes, for sure in English. First of all, it's a big honor to be with you guys here. It's fun. I'm feeling good about that. And second, I'm hyperactive, so I'm a little bit will move when I speak, if it's okay with you guys. If not, I'm going to do Ritalin. Anyway, my name is Asher Swissa. I'm from Jerusalem. As a little kid, I started with a punk band when I was young, and I go direct to electronic music. I didn't know what I'm doing. In the end, people told me that this is trance music. I put guitar inside, and it's become Skazi. I'm working all over the world. I'm playing every week almost in festivals in the world. Because that, my English is sound like that, because I'm speaking with people that no one is from England or from USA. Everyone is from different countries, so this is the English that I now
practice.
Yeah, practice. I'm producing electronic music. I said that before. I start with the actually the Psy scene in 1999. Since then I'm doing music, and like my tattoo, music is my life. This is what I do since then. I'm not married, I'm married to my music, and this is one of my stuff.
Thank you, Skazi. Shuki Perry, Anova, please.
I'm Shuki Perry. I manage Anova Music. I've been working actually for 10 years in Anova. I started as a musician and developed the company as we grew old. We started as a label which operates in Israel, and eventually we understood that what we want to do is manage artists, and now we are focusing on managing not a big number of artists who we develop worldwide and in Israel. We work with the artists on all their business aspects, their publishing, their live, their recordings, their strategy, everything. And what we do basically is we don't consider ourselves as an Israeli label. Like when we, let's say we work with a new artist, we start to promote him, we start to release singles. We don't do it in Israel, build the artist, and then wait for success and go outside. From day one, we develop the artist outside of Israel in certain territories. Now we're working with a number of very promising acts, Lola Marsh, Garden City Movement, we work with Rockfor, Vadat Chargim, that's it.
All right, thank you for everybody for the introduction, and we start now the discussion phase of this panel. And Mr. Trotter, I wanted to ask you first, when you listen to an Israeli band or a singer, songwriter, everything that comes from Israel, what do you look for? What does your ear looking for when you listen to the sounds that are created outside of your local music scene?
Okay, I do think that rock and roll is American and English. Maybe Australian, maybe some people from the north of Europe, but most of the other people, they can't sing rock and roll. So this is my opinion, of course, including Italian act. I don't think Italian act that play rock and roll, you can get it them serious. So what I expect from a band from Israel, or what I expect from a band from Hungary, I expect roots. I expect a melange of roots and contemporary music. If it's in jazz field with jazz, if it's in electronic combined with electronic, if it's in rock, yes, combined with rock. But I do not expect copy of what the Americans and the English, they do much better than all of us.
A follow-up question about it. Does the Hebrew sound or the Hebrew language is a factor in what do you call roots? Or if someone take roots music from Israel with an Eastern sound or an Arabic sound, does it matter if it's sang in Hebrew or in other language?
I personally, and I'm saying something that maybe most of the people disagree, but I'm not really keen that much about the words. Mm-hmm. I'm keen about how the words sound. So, I mean, a song is a song, is not a poetry, is not a book. And with full respect, we love Bob Dylan, we love Neil Young, we love Bruce Springsteen, that they write beautiful lyrics, but because they sound very good. So I definitely like the sound of a local language.
Yes.
At the same time, if someone wanna sing in English or in Spanish or whatever he likes, he can. But I always think that the best way to be international is to start from the proper roots.
Yes.
And to use the roots to go outside the world.
Excellent, thank you. Mr. Bonham, I wanted to ask
the same question with a different version, because festivals, as Mr. Tota said correctly, I think, is a different stage than promoting in the local outside of festivals. Have this almost all of them has exploring stages. What do you look for when you listen to outside the to music outside of your country? What sounds, what language, what, if you look for roots, if you look for the imitation of rock and roll, things that we love, please tell us.
It's I always look for something special, something what I've never heard, which is really hard to find, because as we are music professionals, so we listen to many kind of music from all over the world. But I always like to, so it's really hard to explain this, but it's something catches, something what touches me. So it's like something what I've never heard. So maybe it could be a combination of two different styles, or a special instrument used in a, like a banjo in a metal band. So something like this. But it's what I need to look for this stage. It's it's great that I have some guys, the promoters who Nora mentioned. Mm-hmm. So we received already proposed bands who are, yes, already quite well known. Then I have to listen to them. But it's for example, I had to listen 77 bands, who just six of them will play here yesterday and today.
Yes.
But you know, like if we check a YouTube link, or we check the web page, it's not the same like when they play in live. I always try to find live videos on YouTube, because it's totally different. So yeah, but there is no good answer for this question.
Can you can you mention a band or an artist that you saw here, or not here, or Israeli artist that you heard of that made that click in your heart or in your ear?
It's my second time in Israel. Last time it was also a showcase.
Yes.
There we had to listen to 36 bands or something like this for 2 or 3 days. It was a lot, really. Well, there was Maya Isakovic, as I think you know her, and it was great because she performed with her duo version, not, yes, with the whole band. Later on, I checked the band version at YouTube, but this duo, it was great. It was so simple, and I like simple music. A drummer and the guitar and vocals, that's all. And they did on stage what they had to do on stage.
I ask you what I ask Mr. Trot about language. It's important. A lot of artists here are battling with the thing of language, to sing in English, to sing in Hebrew, to sing in Arabic maybe. And they do it because of the international market. They're battling it because of the international market. They seem it's easier to break out when you sing in English, because English is the international language. But what Mr. Trotter said, it doesn't necessarily important. What do you think about it?
There's a lot of similarities with the Israeli music scene and the Hungarian music scene, because no one else on the world speaks this language. So it's you have to decide, and it's in Hungary. I have many talk about this with bands, like if they sing in English, the radio won't play them. If they sing in English but they have two singles in Hungarian, then the radio will play that, but then their fans will go to their concert, and there they will sing in English. And in Hungary, people doesn't speak English. It's horrible, really, really. So the movie, we don't have subtitled movies in the television. Everything is in Hungarian. We don't let the people study in English. It's horrible. So that's why people get confused when in the radio they have to listen to a song in English, and then they realize that it's a Hungarian band, that they are not Hungarian, they are singing in English. So maybe it's similar to the Israeli scene, but I totally agree with Claudio that the lyrics are not that important. I really like hip hop, and I like international hip hop. I have some Japanese hip hop or Arabic or Israeli or many, and this is where the way how they say the lyrics, this is much more important, the rhythm and the beats, and not what they say. So it's a big question how they have to. So we have some big pop acts in Hungary they became big because they are singing Hungarian, so they have a huge fan base. Then they wanted to go to abroad, and they switched to English, and it was horrible if they want to translate their lyrics to English, and it doesn't sound like this. It doesn't. They are not familiar with the English.
Yes,
it's not true, and so. Yeah, they have to decide. Yeah, but there are some music like rock music, what is better in English. But Israeli bands singing much better in English than the Hungarian ones. That's true.
That's a nice compliment.
Yeah.
Ms. Pinter, I wanted to ask you. A lot of people in the crowd and are dealing with networking. How to get to a festival like Sziget? What to do in order to receive such a great stage? Tell us from your experience, what is the today with Facebook and even LinkedIn and all the social networking, and like everyone can arrange a tour, and what to do in order to get to a festival such as Sziget?
Yes, we have lots of social networks. We are in Facebook. We have official Facebook central page, which is in English, and we have other sub Facebook sites in every language, where we have a promoter. We have Italian, we have French, we have German and Hungarian also. We have fan pages, and we are using Twitter, Instagram, and every surfaces, which is now increasing with the communications. We have a content department, and we are planning what to announce when. We have many promotion activities. We have competitions like campfire competition. This is a little venue of Sziget when street musicians can apply with a video, and the Facebook people can vote for them, and the winners will play. So it's we are using every part of the internet and others.
But what are the odds of someone that that turned to you via social network to get really on stage? Does he really need, or do you need a better connection, such a promoter, such a local promoter from Israel to get to you? Maybe a friend that you I don't know saw in the airport sometimes. How does it really happen?
Can I ask something to compliment? How many artists are booked through the usual procedure with booking agents for the festival, and how many artists are booked like independently? Because, you know,
Mark Arnell.
Yeah, it's most of them are booked across booking agencies.
Exactly.
So we do it in the legal way because it's much better for us. And there are many agents who has big acts. And if we book that big act, then we receive some more proposals, and we want to do something good for that agent, so we book the smaller acts from his roster also. That's how it works.
Yeah, it's very important to actually, in a stage, you need someone to represent you who already knows
Yes.
the festivals and the scene, and usually independently you can do it through a conference like this, or through a very special crazy gimmick with an email that someone sent you. Say, oh man, this crazy, this guy is singing in Hebrew but are doing fine. You know, you can get interested about something just, you know, randomly. But usually it's a very orderly network of how shows are being booked in Europe.
Yes.
You know?
About that, Asher, I wanted to ask you about the differences of breaking out today and in the past. Please, from your you know, wide experience, tell us how different is these days now and then.
Okay. First, I would like to have a question for our audience. How many of you are active artists?
Nice.
And, are you all interested in international career? Wow. Okay, great. So, it's very different. It is so much easier today. There is lots of great music, and if you aim to live as a musician, as an active musician, it's very easy to get gigs with clubs, with people you simply knock on the door via Facebook message or whatever. You find a fellow band in Hungary, one in Amsterdam. You tell them, come to Israel, stay in my place, I'll use your guitar, I'll use your bass drum. And we used to call it MySpace tours, at the era of MySpace.
Yes.
And since then it
ancient days.
Yeah, since then it really developed a lot. And we came with Bonafide 3000. Our first gig was canceled. But on that gig, on the ground of this gig, we built a tour of 5 concerts. And on one of the festivals, we played a room, half of this stage, on the first day of the festival, and the owner of the festival was like, and he said, you must play the main stage on the last night of the festival. So this is how, and at first we received gigs because we could come on stage in 7 minutes. So when they don't have 2 stages in some festivals, or still they have, but they don't have the time and they need music, we came technically prepared with our gear on a small rack, iPad mix, headphones, everything, monitor, all the mix is ready, like a DJ, left, right. Give us 7 minutes, we are on your stage. So what happened, the band, without an agent, without a label, grew like this. In 18 months, 150 dates in Europe, in the US, we played Jones Beach, 15,000 people with Third Eye Blind. We were invited to the conference room of Atlantic Records to play to New York A&Rs and promoters. Mm. We played there for Jack Joseph Puig, who's the VP of A&R at Geffen Records and a well-known producer, with Rihanna and with Lady Gaga and Guns N' Roses. We've made an event with him in the presence of Rick Rubin at East West Studios. Miracles happens everywhere. And this is just like this, you know? And we didn't get penetration on YouTube. It was strange because we didn't have the song. We had the band, great music, but not something that runs on its own without the live performance.
Yes.
So there are so many ways to make it these days that were not available. When I began with Noah, Geffen Records told me, why are you approaching us at all? And I said, you took an unknown band from the distant Seattle, Nirvana, and you made them big. And you took a guitar player that was on ECM Records and you made him popular like a pop star, Pat Metheny. You take the girl from Tel Aviv because you don't have international artists at all and you want to expand. And there isn't a talent like this. And we were so fortunate because at the time, Geffen were signing according to the talent and not according to their ability to market the artist. They serviced the artist. They said, we make it available. They did not push at the time.
Yeah.
They were so successful. So we were lucky. It can't happen these days anymore. But there are so many other ways today. And we learned that there are 2 layers to success. One layer is for the artist to fulfill themselves, make the music, record, create a supporting community that allows them to live as musicians and artists. And then there's another layer to do the duet with Sting, as Noah did last week in at the Olympia in Paris. 20 years after they toured together in Europe, he called her to come on stage with him.
Mr. Tota, I just want to
support not only the words but the passion that he put in his words. This is very important because, as far as I understand, most of the people in here they are artists, right?
Artist industry.
Okay, so I mean, basically, in over 40 years, because I was working in radio, in free radio, for 3.5 years when I started. Was 17 years old when I start, and then I start my own company in 79. So in over 40 years of working and doing everything that you can imagine, I learned one rule. There are no rules. So the only rule is that there are no rules. So do not get thinking that because of the stupid homologation that we have all over the world, because of all this McDonald's way of doing everything. I mean, all the town that looks the same, all the music look the same, all this crap, all this shit. Do not think that that is the only way, because it's not. Especially in these days, because we are living in this horrible world, all over the world, there are a lot of opportunity for real people, for real music, for real passion, for real life. And so be yourself, be fucking yourself. Never, never do different like that.
Skazi, I wanted to ask you from the artist perspective about breaking out to the international. First of all, personally, when did you know that you want to do it outside and not in here? Secondly, you work mostly as in the electronic music industry. You perform as a DJ and also but live, but doing electronic music. Is it really different to be an artist who creates electronic music from abroad than like a band who needs to travel with all the players and et cetera, et cetera?
First of all, I want to say that there is no rules, you're right, but there is a game. We need to play the game.
Of course.
But the rules, there are no rules, but the games is, we know it, and we talk about this later for sure. And about the band music and the electronic, I can tell you that as an electronic artist, for you, all of you guys, it will be much easier to go outside than a band. This is for sure. Yeah. I can tell you that. This is 100%. I did that way. This way, I was struggling as a band to do it as a punk band. I was playing for free. I was going by myself to places. I start from zero. As a band, I stay zero. As when I start to make electronic music, then there's no borders. There's no words inside. It's more catchy. You can make some tricks with the music. You can be smart with the idea to put your music in some fail video. And then the fail video, everybody see it and they hear the music in the background. And then boom, you catch it. You got it. You got like 6-7 million hits. That's it. Somebody will ask, what is this music? There is many techniques in these games, how to take your music and put it in front. And for you guys, you need to be only creative in this one. As a band, listen, for me, as an Israeli guy, I did never sing in Hebrew. In my punk band, or just when I've been in army band, it was in Hebrew, but I was not the singer, so it was okay. But as a electronic, I can tell you there's no rules. The music can go more far because there's no words inside. And if there is a word, it's one pre-drop sentence. Drop the do the and then the drop come, you know, easy. So this is one. Second thing, yeah. You know what
that,
I mean?
That was Kazi Easy Guide.
No,
for doing electronic
I tell
music.
You what, that's
I
the honest
took
guy.
Notes.
Yeah, I can tell stories, but I can tell the real
if
thing.
If Ludwig van Beethoven can listen to this, he will be very upset.
I know, but you know what? I make sometimes a foolish video of 15 seconds and I have 6 million hits for nothing, man. Know. You know what
we
I
all,
mean?
We all appreciate honesty.
Yeah, and I think these guys want to get honesty. You know, we want to get to the stages. They want to get to the networking. They want to get, listen, to Ziget, if me, as Skazi, will send them a message, they will give a fuck about me. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But if Helicon will send it, or, you know, Omega, then it will be something else.
That's why I wanted to ask Shuki. I see you as a middleman between the Israeli industry and the international industry, because you know the scene around here, and you have connections out there. So when a brand approaches Anova, what do you look for, and how do you tell them, listen to me, you're very nice, but you won't make it out there, or I think you have something, let's work about it. What do you look for?
You know, I'm in a position to give comments to artists that I work with. And if I don't work with the artists, I'm not in a position to say, if you do like that, because who the fuck am I? You know, everything can be really successful if you have something. I'm, you know, basically, first of all, there's a limited amount of artists that we can work in Innova. So it starts with that we can't work with a lot. So we just need to be very picky. Now, when I work with an artist, or every manager works with an artist, it's a relationship. It's like family. You start to work from day zero, and you know, it's a ride. And so, first of all, it needs to be people that I like to hang around with and can have a conversation and can make sense together. And there needs to be chemistry, personal chemistry, even before the music. Secondly, you know, we've worked for many years and worked with a range of artists. Basically, what I'm looking for songs and the performance. It's so basic. If an artist writes good songs and he can perform them well and he's original, it's interesting for me. But the way I see it, it's also I have a personal taste. So it's very limited, the amount of artists that I can really. And if I start to work with an artist gradually, because it's not like, hey, come on, let's sign. You know, it doesn't work like that with us. It works in a lot of places like that, obviously. But it's, you build a relationship and you have to believe in the potential. If I believe in the potential, okay, I want in. And if I don't really see it, if I don't believe in it, then maybe it's not for me. And that doesn't say that the artist can't really be a mega successful artist. You know, that's just my point of view.
You talk about the potential. I want to ask you, and after that, Asher, it's a marathon, I think. We all agree about. I want you to talk about a bit about this. What do you expect? If Skazi, you should point this to. It can turn out in a month, a year, 2 years. When do you know when to give up? Or what is the personal qualities that you need in order to take this marathon
Every artist needs to get paid, right? So you go, as long as, you know, if it doesn't come, it doesn't come. Everybody knows it doesn't work, you know? It's not your job. If you manage to do it your job, you can continue.
Asher, what do you think about
the marathon? I tell you a short story. When I pushed
short, please.
Yeah, the Yael Naim album with I'm a New Soul, everybody told me, yeah, you are special, you have this taste, you're alternative, but this time you really lost it altogether. Asher, what's happening to you? I said, well, I'm getting older. And they said it's not going to work, there's no accent, songs in Hebrew, too many, etc., etc., etc. One year later, my lawyer calls from New York. I'm an asshole. I'm an asshole. And in the first 3 months, she sold in France 300,000 units. And she played on radio on NRG, which is the top 40, on FIF, which is the jazz, and on Europe 1. There was never before something like this. People don't remember because it takes you time to cross over and to move from one format and to grow to the next format of radio, especially in France, which was very conservative in 2005. And then comes this guy from Apple and takes the I'm a New Soul to introduce the first MacBook Air. And it becomes the first artist ever since then to reach number 9 on Billboard 200 albums.
And she also was in the Simpson family.
Okay.
In the Simpson episode.
And not only that, she was considered, yeah, she's not focused, she's this and this, and everybody had a word to say about her. And, you know...
About the focus...
So you saw the potential.
Joie de la musique, singer of the year in France. And
about the focus, I wanted to ask Skazi about it. I think every international artist sacrifices something when he looks to go out in the international market. How did you... what did you think about your local crowd, about the international crowd? I think in some time in your career, it was important to you to get back here and do something here in our language. Tell us, please, about it.
Okay, first of all, about the give up, I want to say something about the people that when you need to give up. And I say you never need to give up. And one thing, why? Because when you're a musician, it's part of you. You want to give up on yourself. This is a thing. I'm a musician, I'm a musician all my life, and I was never give up. Okay, I'm not the guy that standing with a guitar and singing solos, you know, but I'm doing it in these days. I live my dream. My sacrifice is that my dream is my life. I don't have anything else than music. I'm living in the music. I wake up and I'm in the studio. I just, until 7 o'clock in the morning, was here. Before that, I was in something else. I'm living inside my music. And this is my sacrifice in life. I don't have family. I have many girlfriends, this is for sure. But I don't have like a wife and kids, because I'm full focused in that one, and I didn't even thought about this one. You know what I mean? So this is about the sacrifice. Now ask me the question, because I forgot. I made it.
Actually, I need to go to my distinguished guest from abroad, because we have a short time. I wanted to ask you, in Israel, to be a successful artist internationally, it's sort of a national pride. And I wanted you to reflect from your knowledge on country, in Italy and Hungary. What does it say to be like a band in Italy that succeeds outside? Is it people in Italy looks at it as a national pride, as something that you need to look up to?
I mean, I would say that most of Italian acts, they have a dream to be international. Few of them they are. I mean, Eros Ramazzotti is international, Laura Pausini is international, Zucchero is international. A lot of jazz artists are international. A lot of world music from Italy. Ludovico Einaudi is international. I wouldn't mention pride, to be honest. I think it's more really in the mind of the artist. And I just want to say something about the fact of never give up. I fully agree, of course. But on the other side, I want to say something that maybe can sound controversial. Not everyone is an artist. Not necessarily because you write songs or you play an instrument, you are an artist. So not necessarily because you are not successful, it's fault of the business or it's fault of something. On one day, every one of us, and this is not only about music, it's about everything, you should watch yourself on the mirror and say, I'm doing the right thing? I mean, I am an artist, I am really saying something that is important. Not all of them are artists. And in a way, it's important to release spaces, because having said that the world is full of beautiful music, is also full of crap music. We don't need that. So please, stay home. People that do crap music, we don't need you.
Ms. Pinter?
Yeah, so it's back to the question. It's in Hungary, so the Hungarian bands don't really touring abroad.
Oh, really?
Not really. Not so. It's not like many bands are doing shows in London. They're doing sold out shows in London for Hungarian people who's living in London. So who would be interested in a small Hungarian band, or maybe the biggest Hungarian band, to buy a ticket and watch them in London? Who? Why? it's going like this. It's like I receive many emails from friends and from agents and from my network that, hey, we have this band, they are really good, they're going for a European tour, and can you do something, a club show or something? But why shall we book an Estonian band or a Ukrainian band to Budapest? Why? There will be three Estonian tourists will go there. Why? It doesn't matter.
Maybe.
It's like maybe if they know about it. If you have money for promotion, for PR, but you don't have. So it's like what they could do is like to play the local community, yeah, what they are doing, or you don't need to. So you can knock on the doors of festivals, try to do this, but because festival has the opportunity to book smaller bands and to show them to bigger audience, because we have the money for this, we have the stages, everything. Not for clubs, but for clubs, you don't need to knock on doors of clubs, but you need to knock on doors of similar bands. So if there are many good examples for this, that there are friends,
yes,
of, so there are many bands who became friends and then they do a tour together, and if
double billing,
and there is a big,
even an opening slot,
there is a big German band and the Hungarian one find them and then they play together in Germany where the German one is the headliner, and then they will play in Hungary with the different billing. It works mainly with metal bands. I know many metal bands, yes. Hardcore and that
metal, hardcore, punk, stuff like
that. Yeah, they stay at their place in their house,
trash it.
Yeah, get back to punk and stay professional in the same time.
Skazi wanted to comment?
I want to say about the, let's say if we take a Hungarian band, okay, a good one with the local music, and they have a very nice hook, you know, that it's catchy. We say that the music is talking and it's catchy. We take out the music, we put the singer, we drop the beat like style of what's going on today, let's make deep house, trance or something, we make it the hits of the clubs. Then this can make a nice push for the band. If the management will think good about this, and I can tell to you guys, if you're making a regular music, make another mix for the clubs. Because the radio, it's not today the focus. Today nobody listen to music in radio, actually. People are listening to music in clubs, in bars, in weddings, in everything.
Yeah, remixes always helps.
So
yeah,
this is what I'm saying, help, you know, yeah. In Israel, for me, if you tell me, I want to play...
We all know the case of Asaf Avidan, actually, that is really, really great breakout was because of,
Remix. Amazing example. This one,
thank you.
It's the best example you can say for the guys.
Okay, let's go to drink something. We are finished.
Actually, we are a bit... We don't have a lot of time, and it's the actually time for questions.
Get drunk!
Questions from the audience before Skazi gets drunk. I don't know how really the question works. They have a microphone. All right. So someone wants to ask questions.
Yeah, there you
go. No, it's Heather. Shukuru. Someone question.
Yeah. Sure. When people approach you to be in a festival, you say you have dozens of bands that you have to listen to. What would catch your eye? Is it a cover letter that is good? Is it a live video versus something that's recorded in the studio? What kind of thing would give someone, you know, the extra edge for you to focus on that?
I'm prepared for this question. So it's, I received tons of emails like this, but it's so it's very good if we so the band has to be true and real and get the roots, but you need to be professional in a way. So like I need informations, I need to know where you played before, where will you play next time. I need links, but not a lot of links. I don't want to receive a 30 megabyte email with attachments. No, I want to receive links with proper information. And please take care of one thing: that if there is a biography of a band, many times the band puts some very important information with bold, you know. So like, and if we who receive tons of emails, we just look on this and we see U2, AC/DC, Red Hot Chili Peppers, and this. With bold, and we think that, oh wow, this is a band with something. And if you read the whole sentence, it means that the band, when they visited Miami, they stayed in a hotel nearby to this studio where this band recorded their album. Don't do this. Don't lie to us, please. Really, it happened many times. And I want to see The Rider, for example. So I want, if there is the best way, if I receive one link with a password, so it's a bit hiding, so it's something secured or something like this, that I can enter to your website and there is a press release, good quality press photos, rider, biography, some downloadable MP3s, or maybe whole albums. If I like it, I will download it for sure. So something like this, give me something for free and give me the proper information. That's the most important.
All right, another question from the audience? Sure.
If you're an independent artist in Israel and you don't have a record company, how do you manage yourself to perform outside the country?
with no management, like
DIY.
How do you know how to pick the right manager? And
I'd like also I'll try to.
I think you need to study. You need to check. You know everything is online. There's many articles about how to get started, what to do. You need to do trial and error. You need to try something. If it doesn't work, you do something else. You don't need. Everyone starts independent, you know, and I think that you should think what your strength is, and just this should be the first thing. You know, you do like this crazy. You decide, okay, I want to do a really good video. Of course, you need a good song, you need a good band, everything. But do a really good video, okay? Just send a video, two words, and if someone will like the music, he will take it. It's about the music. It's what Skazi said, there's a game. You need to play the game. You need to be interesting enough for people to reach to you. They need somehow to hear about you. And how to do it is very hard work, and we really can't explain exactly how to do it, but it starts with places like this. It starts with the conference of Atzolelet in the winter. It starts with showcases when you can just independently apply to go to play at Reeperbahn or to go to play at all kind of showcases. And then you have to start somewhere, but you have to be active, because if you wait and say, okay, well, how, then it won't happen. You have to just be active.
Shuki?
I mean, the only thing that I want to add about all of this is a game, is our passion, but is a work, is a serious work that deserve serious attention.
It's a job.
Deserve people studying, deserve people knowing what they are doing. Not necessarily. As an artist, you are the same like all the others. You need to know what you are doing. You can't wait that someone else is working for you. The first thing is you need to know how to do things, how is the structure of the business, which are the roles, which are the responsibility, and you need to learn by yourself. And obviously, as I said, you need to be catchy, because otherwise no one will bother about you.
You asked how to choose the good manager. Actually, there isn't a good manager. Because each one of us in this business, we have more artists which we never had success with, and sometimes we have a few that gives us reputation. So you never know until you have to make your mind and decide, and time will tell you whether it was right or not.
And another thing that we all know is that lots of managers, they really don't know what the fuck they are doing. It's nothing against him. He knows what I'm talking about. Lots of managers all over the world, they are sister, father, mother, lovers, lawyer, etc., etc., but they don't know nothing about what they do. They are just at the right time in the right place.
The other very important note, the tsunami of success is as strong as the tsunami of failure. Remember it. If success decides to come upon you, you can make mistakes, lose your talent, forget the words, be wrong with, bad with people, everything. Success will not let you go down until a certain point. But you really have to fight hard against success when the wave is coming.
Skazi, you want to?
There is the best tool today is for us to do things as an independent artist too. It's the internet, it's the Facebook, it's all of this. You can get access for everything. If you have something good, I promise you guys, if you have something good, you listen. Everybody will listen to it and it's good, it will say it's good. And it will go on and go on. If it's something regular, it just will go. But the access for all the places and the labels is in front of you. It's in your phone and it's your computer. And another thing that is very, very important for all of you to do It's to keep yourself always there, always that they will know about you. And in that I will finish that I said that I got CDs for all of you here, my new album, and try to be like that.
Other questions?
I think for you the fusion will be the answer. If you take the electronic music and put the rock together and then sing on top of it, you will be there, because the rock alone is nice, but as this gentleman say, an amazing advice is the American do it better, but I think the American don't do better the fusion in between, because the electronic music is actually the strongest part is Europe. I can say the trance, the electronic, this one is from Israel. We are the roots for that. Everybody can disagree or agree. I can tell you that it's come from here. Everyone, even Tiesto started his career here in the Oman 17. You know what I mean? So this is what I say, the fusion for you.
I don't think it's about the genre of music. It's about two things that most of us have said, songs and performing. These things, they will never go away. I mean, the songs, if the songs are catchy, if the songs are good, they're good in any way you play. Think about Johnny Cash performing the Depeche Mode song. I mean, no one was thinking he should do that. And he do it in such an amazing way that it means that the songs was great. On the other side, live music, and when I'm talking about live music, I'm including electronic music, so I'm not saying that it's different. Is a performance that is happening at that moment in time, and the energy from the audience to the stage and from the stage to the audience is not replicable. So these two things will not go away ever. So as much as you are either writing good songs, because I mean you can be even a good songwriter and not a performer. I mean, lots of, in the 50s and the 60s, we had, and in the 40s, we had so many amazing writers that they were not performing. Or if you are a great performer, you will have your time.
One last question, please. Anyone? No?
Let's get drunk!
All right. Yeah. I want to thank you, everybody. Thank you. See you.